Before Elvis ever set hearts racing on our shores, there was a homegrown sound that was just as exciting to the ears of Britain's youth. By the 1950s, British motorbikes were the fastest, most desirable, and coolest thing on two wheels anywhere in the world. For Britain's bikers, a passion for speed has always been part of the thrill.
I think the second day that after motorbikes were invented, two people met and had a race.
Whether on the track...
Some of the guys would hold the throttles open by various means, like of elastic bands and things, and just hang on.
Or doing 100 miles an hour with the ton-up boys on the A406.
You can bet he's the boy who's going to go flashing past with the throttle wide open. And you can bet you he's the boy in 6 months who's going to be in a coffin.
British riders helped create the legend of the motorcycling rebel.
The drug that they were addicted to was adrenaline.
It weren't just about having fights and like being yobs. I mean, we was, and we did.
But this was no brief post-war love affair with speed and style. Its roots go far deeper into Britain's past.
The prime exponent was, of course, Lawrence of Arabia.
For over 40 years, British motorbikes ruled the road.
At 70 mile an hour on a British motorbike, you felt like you was doing 170 mile an hour.
It was in the early 1960s that British motorbikes entered their most notorious era. Rockers had an unruly and threatening reputation. The press was full of tales of transport cafes stuffed with young men who liked nothing more than tearing up bypasses at 100 miles an hour.
That post-war generation didn't want to go to the pub, listening to pianos and whatnot. It wasn't for them. They wanted excitement. They were living a time known as the jet age.
Let's pass a test and let's be a turn-up boy.
They were known as cafe racers, and their most notorious hangout was the Ace Cafe in northwest London.
At 16, you can buy your first motorbike, so straight away, you pass your test, I want to try it, 500, then you're ready for the Ace Cafe.
The Ace was a somewhat down-at-heel transport cafe. Legendary among leather-clad bikers for its jukebox stocked with the killer sounds of the day.
The spoon that served the sugar was nailed to the counter. Most of the furniture was nailed down. The jukebox was nailed down.
But what made it truly infamous was the high-speed road that ran right past it. London's North Circular Road became the Ace's very own racetrack.
The party piece was to come past here flat out.
Tales of high-speed dares cemented its place as a social menace in the public eye. The thrill that earned ultimate bragging rights was a jukebox race. A rider's challenge timed to the length of a pop song.
Coming, jukebox. Coin in, up to the hanger lane, dual carriageway, do a Yui, and down before the record stops. So you come out the edge gaff, flat out, turn, flat out, back.
The dangers were obvious, but a whole generation of young bikers couldn't get enough of it. However, motorcyclists hadn't always been seen as the scourge of society. Back in the early 1920s, Britain's roads were more suited to the horse and cart than the motorcycle, but bikes were being eagerly adopted as a means of everyday transport.
That's what makes us very different from America, that in Britain, the first kind of motorised transport that takes off is the motorcycle. They're used in the 1920s in various ways, not just for fun and not just for commuting, but also businesses. They're used as sort of delivery vehicles, beginning to replace horse and cart.
The roads would have been a difficult place. They would have been empty of traffic, but they would have still had their own hazards. Horses were everywhere, which can sometimes be unpredictable, especially if they're suddenly startled by a loudish motorbike coming upon them. And of course, there's all the horse muck and everything else that has to be dealt with.
Traffic coming towards you was not necessarily friendly, so that horse riders could wave in a friendly way, or they might even try and have a go at you with a whip.
You have this ideal, thinking back to it, of being beautiful, open, sweeping roads, but actually a lot of the time it would have been on little more than goat tracks, avoiding potholes, trying not to fall off, and missing stray dogs.
As roads were gradually tarmacked and petrol stations began to appear, there was something stirring in the biker psyche. For a war-torn generation, bikes promised thrills and speed like nothing else.
I mean, when guys had lived through the horrors of the First World War, then going fast on a bike was just exhilarating. It wasn't anything scary about it, because you weren't being shot at while you were doing it. So, speed was an exhilaration rather than something to be afraid of.
Speed freaks then were known as promenade Percys, and riding fast was an addiction that thrived, despite the perils.
Bikes were a little bit hairy, probably more dangerous proportionally than cars, than if you compared the two today.
And all of a sudden, an average guy could get that same sense of exhilaration and speed and kind of progression and movement that only a very few incredibly wealthy people with, who had, you know, access to planes or fast cars, experienced previously.
That sort of freedom to be in control of that, even relatively modestly powered machine, was like a trip to the moon, I suspect.
Riding fast on Britain's barely usable roads, with no speed limits, attracted a certain kind of adventurer. None more so than T.E. Lawrence. Known as Lawrence of Arabia for his exploits in the Middle East during the First World War, he struggled to find a place in peacetime life. He had grown weary of the press attention his war heroics brought. Thrashing along on a motorbike offered the escape of adrenaline thrills and a chance to avoid the limelight. Lawrence was the original turn-up boy.
He would ride from Bovington Camp to London and back again just to do it. And when you imagine the roads of those days, it's unthinkable.
He wrote, "When my mood gets too hot and I find myself wandering beyond control, I pull out my motorbike and hurl it at top speeds through these unfit roads for hour after hour. My nerves are jaded and gone, near dead, so that nothing less than hours of voluntary danger will prick them into life."
Finally, he turned up one Sunday, coming right across Dartmoor from Plymouth to North Devon, where I lived, on his 10-horsepower, 100-mile-an-hour Brough Superior nickel-plated motor bicycle.
In the 1920s, there was only one make of bike that offered the performance and glamour Lawrence was looking for. His machines of choice were made by Brough Superior, the first superbikes. George Brough named his business Brough Superior after he split from his father's company, which was called plain old Brough. He wanted to make the very best and fast bikes, and only something superior would do. George was seeking motorbike perfection for those that could afford his high asking price.
George Brough started in 1919 and finished in 1939 and made about 3,000 bikes, no two the same, in that 20-year period. And they are today the Holy Grail, if you like.
Brough was an innovator with a keen eye for detail and a sense of style that marked his creations as the most modern around.
Motorcycles that were made around that time would really not come on an awful lot from a bicycle frame. Brough were one of the first manufacturers to go with really styling that we would recognise today in terms of curves.
from day one. His petrol tanks encompass the top tube on the frame, whereas everybody else still had these flat tanks, these slab tanks. So in one, George Brough got the styling right, and it took the rest of the manufacturers 8, 9, 10 years to catch up.
At his Nottingham factory, Brough's machines were made to fit his wealthy clientele's exact requirements.
He would, like a good tailor, would measure you for the bike and the handlebars. If you were short, Lawrence of Arabia was short, he put in a small back wheel and he would sit you on the saddle and measure where your hands and make the bars.
The speed and style of an SS80 or an SS100 was for the elite few. They cost more than the average man's yearly wage. For a man like T.E. Lawrence, Brough Superior's promise of unparalleled performance and exotic exclusivity was the perfect match.
On a motorbike, you can put the world to rights. And I think that was very much part of Lawrence's joy of his riding.
Lawrence himself was a risk taker, somebody who had lived a very full, exciting and interesting life. And so at that point, you know, what other mode of transport could he have had than the Brough Superior? You know, that was the natural fit.
The 1000cc Brough from about 1925 onwards was capable of, in standard form, producing about 50 horsepower then. So that was 100 mile an hour.
A 100 miles per hour motorbike would have been completely outside of everyday experience. Only a select few would have any notion of travelling the roads at that speed. Brough's high-performance superbikes were ideal for Lawrence. He rode 7, crashed several, and kept coming back for more. Buying the latest model SS80 or SS100, he named each one George and referred to them in his writings as Boanerges, a biblical reference meaning sons of thunder. He wrote, "The burble of my exhaust unwound like a long cord behind me. Soon my speed snapped it and I heard only the cry of the wind. The cry rose with my speed to a shriek, while the air's coldness streamed like two jets of iced water into my dissolving eyes. I screwed them to slits and focused my sights 200 yards ahead of me on the empty mosaic of the tar's gravelled undulations. Although he'd survived several crashes relatively unscathed, in 1935, Lawrence and his beloved Boanerges finally ran out of luck.
I heard the motorcycle coming back. I heard the engine suddenly race and then stop.
Came over the brow of a hill and there were two boys on bicycles.
Suddenly, this man who faced death a score of times in Arabia meets a tragic end on a peaceful English country road.
Swerving to avoid the boys, Lawrence had come off his SS100, causing serious head injuries. He died 6 days later. Like many riders, he never wore a helmet. Appalled at the needless death of a war hero, the doctor who attended Lawrence began researching the use of crash helmets.
As a result of Lawrence's crash and the head injuries that he'd sustained, the surgeon campaigned quite vigorously after that. If he had been wearing a helmet, he would have been fine. As a direct result of that, and quite a long time later, helmets did become compulsory.
The The years in which Lawrence had indulged his passion were golden ones for British motorcycles. The interwar period saw an explosion in ownership, and designs were becoming increasingly advanced. Sport too was booming. Britain being Britain, every aspect of riding a motorcycle had been turned into a game. There was a competition event for everything.
The sporting side of it was a big thing, and it wasn't just racing, there was all the club side of it. Every person who was into motorcycles in the 20s would have been in a club. There would have been this huge community, and they wouldn't have just raced, they would have done sort of hill climbs and grass tracks and kind of, they used to do trials, and they'd even do like pillion trials where you'd have someone on the back of the bike to do a trial, and long distance trials, and there was always some kind of club involvement in it all.
Despite their popularity, bikes were seen as challenging and somehow apart from other pursuits, even on the racing scene. Motorbikes started to be perceived in a different way to their four-wheel rivals.
You still get people just riding around in their normal clothes, although in the racing scene, you do start to see stuff developing. The car drivers would always wear white suits, nice clean white helmets and goggles. They were sort of pristinely turned out, so you've got a black leather-clad motorcyclist covered in dirt who, you know, whizzes around lap after lap after lap getting dirty. I don't know, it just, there is this real sort of separation.
The feeling that bikes were a bit different was apparent at the prestigious Brooklyn Circuit. It was one of the only custom-built racetracks in the world and had been an important part of the bike scene from the beginning. Yet even here, bikers were becoming outsiders.
Brooklyn's the most prominent British race circuit that closes in 1939. At that time, there was a real hierarchy of the establishment in the racing community. The motorcycle racers weren't allowed into the clubhouse at Brooklyn's, whereas the car racers were. They were looked down upon even in that scene as well.
But there was one place where the riders were already king. The Isle of Man Tourist Trophy, or TT races. The event was founded in the early 1900s on the Isle of Man, after racing on the roads in mainland Britain had become outlawed. The place became the spiritual home of British bikers. Raced over a 37-mile mountainous circuit, the TT was a challenging time trial against the clock, testing courage to the full.
There really is nothing else like it in the world. There wasn't back then, and I guess there isn't now.
The TT races are about to begin, and all the competitors are lined up. There's a great deal of activity going on at the moment around the starting point.
The rider would come face to face with the starter, who would have his flag in the air, and the guy would set his bike as he wanted it to start.
Oh yes, yes, the starter's flag is going up, and he's watching his chronometer, ready to give the signal for number one, that's Frith, to start on the stroke of 11. And there goes the starter's flag, straight into the sight now.
As the flag drops, he would push, run, with the clutch held in, then he'd let his clutch out and jump onto the saddle. And he would be hoping that it would fire and run straight away and off he'd charge. And most of the time, especially the top guys, they would.
Number two.
They would have got it worked out to such a degree that they'd know how many steps to take before jumping on the bike. It perhaps looks a bit rudimentary or a bit kind of basic, but there was actually an awful lot of science and a lot of thought would have gone into it. Nothing would have been left to chance.
Unlike Brooklyn's, the TT track was on everyday roads, a far more familiar environment for the average rider, despite its pitfalls.
It is a 37-mile track, which are public roads, with hairpins and hills and bumps and villages.
A rough road surface with drain covers and curbs and walls and hedges.
over a mountain, the variation of the course itself, the different conditions.
It's at Ramsey that the mountain course begins, the hardest part of the run. And incidentally, the course passes through some of the most beautiful scenery in the island. But you may be sure the fleeting riders are too occupied to notice it.
They touch today 180, but in the 30s they would have been doing the ton parlance for 100 miles an hour, and on the Sulby Strait speeds there would have approached 110, 120.
Jimmy Guthrie is leading all the way, setting a cracking pace at an average of nearly 80 miles an hour. Slowing up on the turns, can you imagine what his top speed must be?
It was an extreme race that required equally extreme commitment.
Some of the guys would hold the throttles open by various means, like of elastic bands and things, and just hang on. That was as simple as that. Really, they were running quite close to flat out an awful lot of the time.
He's coming down now, round windy, very wide sweep.
Here he comes, I can just spot him. And according to my timing, he's winning.
How they managed to achieve the lap times that they did on the machines of that time, in the conditions, on those roads. Incredible, incredible guys.
The enormous strain on both driver and machine in this grueling 265 miles race can only be appreciated when we realise that they fly around the course for nearly 3.5 hours on end. Difficult corners and a 7-mile climb in each of the 7 laps makes it a thrilling sight for the spectators and a more thrilling struggle for the drivers.
To handle the stresses and strains of such an arduous race, the TT racer of the 1930s needed to be a hardy breed.
When you're riding a bike which has got no real suspension, saddles are not brilliantly comfortable, and, you know, it's a fairly ferocious thing. There was no kind of let-up. It was really, really physical, hard work. These were fit guys who were doing it.
If the riders were tough, the bikes had to be even tougher. For the bike companies, there was more than just pride at stake.
This really can't be underestimated, its importance in terms of motorcycle development.
The TT was an absolutely marvellous proving ground for manufacturers in an era when people were concerned about reliability. Naturally, we buy something today, it's not going to break. Very different time then. And so for a manufacturer to be confident enough to put their machine through 2-3 laps, what better place to prove the reliability of their machine?
As the technology raced ahead, one manufacturer excelled above all others, Norton. For them, winning the TT became an expectation, and wins meant sales.
Often the phrase was, well, which Norton won the TT this year? Not which bike, but which Norton. They dominated.
They had the best riders riding for them. The bikes were the toughest, probably the fastest.
The winner, who by the way won the junior TT earlier in the week, was Guthrie, on a Norton with an average speed of 78.01 miles an hour.
You could see the aces riding the bikes that you could buy, racing. And that was a hell of a thing at the time.
The local salesroom could give you a road version of the very machine that had just won the world's toughest race. Norton's international model was the closest thing to the TT dream the average rider could buy. But Norton's winning streak would be rudely interrupted by world events.
In 1938, Norton won the TT, but for 1939 they virtually withdrew from international racing because they'd started to build bikes for the army.
In 1939, as Britain geared up for war with Germany, there was another team waiting to take Norton's place, BMW.
People know it as the Nazi TT, where the German entrants really basically turned up uniformed and jackbooted.
The Nazi party had taken control of German motorsport, investing heavily in racing technology. BMW had the world champion George Meyer and bikes that were far ahead of the competition.
German government, of course, were behind their car racing and their motorcycle racing efforts. And in the motorcycling, that extended to all classes, with BMW in the 500. The German bikes were actually very good with their shaft drive.
With no Norton factory team to rival them, BMW won first and second places in the senior race.
BMW did win that race, exciting race. No bones about that. And the Germans, that was the first time, if you like, that they'd planted a flag on the top of our mountain.
BMW's second place rider was British man Jock West, shown on the right. He chose not to join in with his team's victory salute. Just 3 months after the TT, Britain was at war with Germany. And the motorbike would be put to military use. Men to ride them also had to be commandeered. Ron Arnold was one of them.
I had no thought at all of riding a motorcycle. Before joining the army, I couldn't drive. I had to specialise in something. Everybody had to specialise. So I became a dispatch rider.
In addition to mechanical systems, the human method of communication still ranks very high in modern war. The dispatch rider is most able to cope with rapidly changing conditions. Upon his shoulders rests the responsibility of maintaining contact between the many positions in the field, even before the more permanent methods of communication have been established.
I think they first gave me a BSA.
Known as DRs, dispatch riders and their bikes were expected to operate in any weather conditions and deliver messages wherever they were ordered to.
In due course, bit by bit, they provided me with the rest of it.
Here, the wise DR does things methodically and takes care in his dressing.
Double texture, rubber, coat, almost down to the ankles. They are goggles. They taught me how to ride a motorcycle and how to use a map that other people could understand what I was referred to on that map.
Trained to adjust himself rapidly and thoroughly, there's little that a fully-fledged DR doesn't know about finding his way, not only with maps, but by making use of his own powers of observation.
You're also issued with a dispatch bag.
You've got to be there by six.
Very good, sir. I'll be there.
I never bother to look what's in it. It's handed to me. I put it round my neck. I go, I deliver it to my officer.
As well as his supposedly weatherproof uniform, the dispatch rider depended on his bike. Birmingham Small Arms, or BSA, were the most common bike in the field, but not always the most popular.
I found the BSA quite cumbersome to be a good road bike. But we're mostly going cross-country. Roads are on German maps.
The SDR memorises the route, taking care not to mark his map, and heads towards the village. There's the road I came along. I'd better get another landmark to make sure. There, that church. Right. Better than asking the way, questions near the fighting line are dangerous. This DR used his brains instead.
If the BSA left something to be desired, Ron much preferred his replacement.
But fortunately, I was handed a Norton motorcycle. It was lightweight to throw it about, to be able to move with it as well. Norton was a very nice machine.
For you, sir. Special dispatch.
Thank you. 6 o'clock. I see you left London at 6 o'clock.
Yes, sir.
That's jolly good time.
Thank you, sir.
After cutting his teeth in England, Ron Arnold was posted to Normandy.
We arrive on the beach. Move. Get off the beach. Move, move, move. Move off the beach. So we leave the beach eventually, and we end up in a meadow. In that meadow, my bike, in its tarpaulin, It's pulled off, and I am now alive.
In the Second World War, Britain used more motorbikes than any other country. By its end, the manufacturers had made more than 400,000 of them. Throughout the conflict, British society had been exposed to motorcycles like never before. Both the clothing and the machines that had been made for the army would have a lasting impact on how the public viewed bikes in the post-war years. In peacetime, as the bike industry began picking up the pieces, new machines were mostly for export and therefore hard to come by. But it wasn't long before Civvy Street was awash with second-hand bikes and ex-War Department stock sold on the cheap.
A lot of surplus motorcycles were converted back to civilian use, you know, were repainted from army khaki into any colour as long as it's black kind of thing to get Britain mobile again.
We're getting a proliferation again of bikes. We've got the ones now from the 20s and 30s. Obviously, the second-hand market grows, the more bikes there are around. So they're becoming more available.
In amongst all the austerity, there was a dream bike that offered a glimpse of what the future might hold. A hand-built fantasy for motorcycle fans that contrasted deeply with the world around it. The bike to end all bikes, the Vincent Black Shadow.
It was the ultimate, it were, and rightly so, you know. They couldn't find a road fast enough to test it on, to do that, even though there was no speed limit then. They used to do all the testing on the A1 at dawn. Its standout feature visually was it had a all-black engine and it had a 5-inch speedometer.
No! Did you ever hear such a noise?
For buyers with lots of cash, there's the Vincent HRD. Most expensive bike on view, costing near £600.
Its cooler-than-cool looks made it a pin-up for British enthusiasts. But its real claim to fame was speed. A highly tuned version of the Black Shadow was taken to the western US state of Utah in 1948, and on the Bonneville Salt Flats, made history.
The American rider in the desert, stripped down to a pair of bathing trunks, and flattened himself along the tank and the seat of the bike, and rode at 150 mile an hour like that, and in a straight line. I mean, these guys were heroes. An unbelievable speed for those days.
Vincent's design stood out in an era of making do as a symbol of progress and engineering skill.
They were in another quantum leap in terms of performance.
Even on British roads, unthinkable speeds could be achieved.
To be able to do 110 was incredible, but to be able to hold 110 with no bits falling off and, nothing going bang was phenomenal.
Record-breaking speed and technical innovation didn't bring the Black Shadow social approval. Bikes had a bit of an image problem, and despite Vincent's state-of-the-art designs, they ceased bike production in 1955.
It wasn't like having a sports car. Even though it was horrendously expensive, it was still a motorbike, and tired with that brush.
Britain was also changing. Society was on the move. Expanding road networks and new out-of-town suburbs drove a boom in the demand for personal transport. As consumerism took hold in the 1950s, the middle class increasingly wanted cars rather than motorbikes. Cars were aspirational status symbols, and they kept you warm and dry.
Every man's got a car. Poor man, a rich man. You can't keep him, the poor man off because he's a poor man or a working man. He's just entitled to have a car on the road as you are.
And it wasn't just aspirations that were evolving. If grown-ups wanted cars, there was a new group that would take motorbikes off their hands. Teenagers.
Don't jump, little children, jump. We're gonna jump, little children, jump. We're gonna jump, little children, mother and father's gone.
You're beginning to get youth subcultures emerging after the war. And it's part of a whole debate in society about these new youths, these young people who are having more money, who are having more independence, the old traditions of respect, whether it's for your parents, for the church, for the establishment, for parliament, whatever, all of those things are under threat in the post-war period. Motorcycles and scooters, of course, become part of that youth generation. Mom and Papa gone. The generation gap becomes a social concern.
The anxiety around teenagers and motorbikes was quick to set in. Marlon Brando's 1953 film, The Wild One, ignited a full-blown moral panic with its portrayal of delinquent bad boys on motorcycles. Brando's sneering, disdainful performance captured a threatening sense of rebellion that was emphasised by the film's use of costumes. The gang's black leather jackets in stark contrast to the ordinary townsfolk. The director made Brando's Johnny menacingly disengaged from authority figures, and the artistic mix worked so well that British censors banned the film.
Where's that bunch from?
I don't know, everywhere. I don't even think they know where they're going. Termites, nutty. 10 guys like that give people the idea everybody drives a motorcycle is crazy.
The British Board of Film Censors described it as a spectacle of unbridled hooliganism. When that hooligan happened to be riding a Triumph, it was no wonder British youths took his image to their hearts. For teenagers, bikes were a way of marking themselves out from the rest of society. They might not always have been able to get the fastest and flashiest around, but for some, it became a lasting love affair.
I was 14, and it was a Norton 600, and it had a sidecar on it, and I gave 10 bob for it.
My first motorcycle was a XWD 350 matchless. When you're 16, it gets in there permanent for the rest of your life, like riding a bike.
Teens created a motorbike scene all of their own, and transport cafes were the centre of this new world. Racing from venue to venue, the cafe racer had come of age.
Young people are hanging out. I mean, maybe they're not old enough to drink yet, they're not able to take part in pub culture, but they also don't necessarily want to be part of pub culture, which is association with the older generation.
I mean, then, them days then, it was coffee. No one drank. No one would drink a beer. No, I drink. Drugs. What's drugs? No one knew what drugs was. But it was clean. It was good, clean fun.
Cafe racers spanned the country. There was soon a place for riders to hang out in every city. The notorious Ace Cafe's position on the inner London Ring Road made it the pit stop of choice for many of the capital's young riders.
It was whizzing around North London. It could be in Birmingham or Manchester. Huge demographic explosion, fast bit of road, neon, a soundtrack, then new soundtrack, rock and roll music.
And you've got the Busy Bee, you've got the Ace Cafe, and they're going to be riding their bikes backwards and forwards to them.
They're just whizzing around from cafe to cafe, hence the term, cafe racer.
You finish work, had your dinner, 8 o'clock, time to go.
What you have is, in the late 50s and early 60s, you have the first generation of post-war young men that haven't been conscripted. They are living in a world where their working conditions, pay, holidays are improving all the time because of government legislation. You also have greater availability of credit, so they're buying motorcycles on credit, they can buy clothing on credit.
Bikes had long ceased to be just forms of practical transport or playthings of the elite. Now they were objects of youthful desire, and they went to the heart of the identity of those who rode them. Like any new social scene, biking would develop its own strict styles, code, and culture.
The image of a rocker back then was motorbike boots with white socks going over. The actual reality of it was you'd be quite posh to be able to afford proper motorbike boots. A lot of the lads I hung around with, they either wore Wellingtons, with turned down, it was a fashionable thing, or ex-army boots. Light blue jeans were a thing that rockers were synonymous with, but that's because they was cheap.
The look of the ton-up boy and rockers didn't always have room for crash helmets.
Some people just didn't wear them because they didn't really take much attention to risk, or there was just too much of an expense. Some did.
Generally, we only wore a crash helmet if it was, if you knew it was going to be really cold, or if we was going on a long run. So if we was back in them days, a long run would be Brighton. The bikes weren't so reliable, but you'd wear a crash helmet, not for safety, but for more to keep the elements at bay.
You didn't really wear a helmet because them days, Billy Fury days, and a crash helmet mucked your hair up.
The thought of putting this thing on you, A, it didn't look so good. B, it flattened your bouffant, your hair.
When you arrived at the Ace Caff, you had the big quiff, forward with the bill cream, it looked right. When you had a helmet on, it was hassle, it just mucked your hair up.
Because it wasn't law at the time, I think the reason you didn't have to wear a helmet, so you never knew the difference. And I used to just love going along with the wind roaring through my hair and...
You do see some fantastic caps being worn, like a white-topped, dark-peaked helmet with a chain across the front, and it's a very stylized look.
One particular item of clothing, though, was not only set to define the bikers as rebels, but destined to become a universal and lasting fashion icon. If you could afford one, a leather jacket was the essential bike accessory.
You start to see the American influence come in with the black leather jacket, which has its roots in a few different areas, but primarily almost a direct appropriation of military uniforms.
Almost all of us wore leather jackets. I mean, my first leather jacket I got when I was 14. Most of my mates couldn't afford new leather jackets, so we had like hand-me-downs from the ton-up boys.
Often bought from military surplus, it was these symbols of rocker life that disturbed older generations.
You can do a direct image comparison between the black leather jacket and the German tank crews. The silhouette and the design, the lapels, is almost identical.
The patches and customized designs on the jackets carried other connotations for those who had witnessed the Second World War.
You're 16, 17, you suddenly get a motorcycle, you put on a leather jacket, so you have patches on the arms, you have patches and badges on the front of the jacket. You also have insignia being painted on the back as well. Your parents, who may have seen lots of images or actually been to war themselves and you know, being close up with the enemy, are going to draw some comparisons to all of this.
Their uniform is black leather. Their hair, a Sergeant Major's nightmare. And the two words on everyone's lips, the ton, 100 miles an hour.
The growing distance between the leather-clad upstarts and wider society became most apparent when the rockers got on their bikes. Roads were a Wild West frontier of unrestricted speed.
We used to race from one roundabout to the other. And you go up and down there, and we found that you went up and down four or five times, and someone would have phoned the police, so the police would arrive, so you go up and down twice.
The cafe racer lifestyle was a dangerous one. Britain's roads were being improved, traffic was growing, and around transport cafes, leaking lorry oil added to the hazards of riding fast.
Now you don't think of risk, I don't think of risk now.
Youngsters are wanting to show off to each other will come past here flat out. And flat out on an old brick bike is somewhere perhaps 80 mile an hour, and on certain machines perhaps just over 100 mile an hour.
Leading the way was the ton-up boy, committed to going as fast as possible regardless of the consequences.
You come into these cafes and you meet them. You meet the ton-up boy. You meet the rogue, like, you know. He won't bother about what you think of his driving. That's all he's bothered about is getting past you, anywhere, at any place, at any time. You can bet he's the boy who's going to go flashing past with the throttle wide open. And you can bet you he's the boy in 6 months who's going to be in a coffin.
Yes, really, I was a ton-up boy.
When he was a ton-up boy, it was speedo. You looked at the speedo, 90, 91, and it gradually creeps up, 100 mile an hour, and then you think, I've just done a ton, you know, and that made the day, because you did a ton.
I had a BSA Gold Star that was actually a clubman's racing bike with lights on, and it's what I started racing on. But I had a younger sister who would be 5 or 6 years old, and I used to go and pick her up from school. You've got the rev counter and the speedo on the BSA like that, and she's watching it, and she goes rushing into her mum, saying, Mummy, we did 100 miles an hour. My mother went mad.
There was another strand to rocker life. Some of their hangouts were notorious for being as rough as their leather jackets. The Chelsea Bridge Boys were an infamous band of rockers who gathered next to a tea kiosk.
It was notorious in the 50s and 60s as a place of ill repute. You didn't go up there, and if you did, you was bad. You was deemed to be a bad boy, or people wouldn't even walk over it. And if you had a scooter boys wouldn't ride over there, because if they did, the scooters got thrown over Chelsea Bridge.
It was hardly Hell's Angels stuff, but always central to the action at the bridge were the motorbikes they doted on. It was these that delivered the real thrills, spills, and adrenaline.
It weren't just about having fights and like being yobs. I mean, we was, and we did, but it was more, for us, it was more like the thrill of getting on the motorbike and riding it and opening the throttle and going as fast as you can and getting it, going into a bend and getting it just right and coming out the other side, and you think, wow, it was just a buzz. That was a common denominator. We all felt that.
Although they rode whatever they could afford, second-hand or perhaps new on HP, cafe racers favoured a certain type of bike. They were influenced by the styling and look of TT racers who, like them, raced on roads. But racing bikes traditionally used single-cylinder engines. For rockers, it was twin-cylinder engines that offered them what they wanted: quicker acceleration and performance geared for the streets.
Twins were generally associated with rockers. Ton-up boys and rockers, generally, because you could tune them and go much faster.
Triumph had set the standard. Their chief designer, Edward Turner, developed the Triumph Twin before the war. And through the 1950s, they released bikes with sporty, American-tinged styling. Their finest hour was with the T120 Bonneville, launched in 1959. Named after a Triumph speed record set at Bonneville Salt Flats in Utah, it was the bike to be seen with,
featuring dual carburetors and era-defining cool. The turn-up boys loved it. In the same year, motorcycle sales hit the roof. Cafe racers may have been setting the fashion for quick and stylish machines, but the bike industry only had eyes for lucrative American exports. Young riders found they had to customise these designs to make them their own.
At no time did any of the manufacturers, the Triumphs and Nortons and whatnot, ever look to the youngsters and ask them what they wanted. The kids bought the machine and then adapted it to how they wanted it.
It's very seldom I'll have a bike more than 6 months. I prefer to chop and change, rebuild. As a hobby, I don't keep them just to as a form of transport. They are a hobby with me. I like to have a bike, and when I've got the maximum performance out of that bike, I'd rather sell it than keep it and install on something else.
People could think that they were Jeff Duke or whoever their particular Norton hero was, John Surtees, whatever, by dropping the handlebars and putting the footrests a bit further back and getting down to it.
Head down, arse up. It was a best position to be in, A, for aerodynamics, and B, to keep control of the bike. If you went into a bend and then you got it a bit wrong.
With a fine weekend, a powerful motorbike, and a girlfriend on the back, the Turn-Up boys set off. 2 short days for riding high and fast, to wind and weave, and often to be a menace.
Huge progress comes about as a consequence of the pursuit of speed, but it does come at a price.
Cafe racers were paying with their lives. In 1960, nearly 14,000 riders under the age of 24 were killed or seriously injured.
One lad that lost his leg. He went on the inside of a coach. The coach was turning left and so was he. It literally, as it swung in, and he ran over his bike and took his leg off.
Underlying the mythical tales of teenage road races was a harsh reality. On the roads around the Ace, the casualties started to mount up.
I'm racing these and bridging back. I'd do 90 mile an hour around there. And some didn't come back because, you know, Neasham Bridge is a well-known place. You could try and take it flat out, but it was impossible.
With the volume of traffic growing and the roads not modernised, there was a wave of popular feeling that this was no longer fun.
Absolute carnage on the road, the casualties went up and up and up. The pursuit of speed at one level was regarded as a noble cause, but for the mass of society, it's often regarded as a threat and a challenge.
The public backlash was keenly felt by the rockers.
We go into cafes and places like that, and they, no leather jackets. There wasn't many places we could go to, so as a consequence, we ended up in less than desirable places. We were just like anybody else. We wanted to hang around with blokes who had the same interests as us. Simple, you know. But because of the reputation, I guess our dress mode and the noise of the bikes and the way, the aggressive way we used to ride, it kind of like all it all melted into a picture which wasn't too appealing to the normal decent people back in them days.
The powers that be were worried, but the establishment hadn't given up on them just yet. An inspired group of vicars had an idea to try and bring the cafe racers back into the mainstream. In 1962, the Reverend Bill Shergold would make a journey to the infamous Ace Cafe. His mission, to try and tempt the wayward youngsters to come to a new youth club and escape unscathed himself. So he plucked up his courage and set off on his motorbike into the unknown. He wrote,
I wrapped a scarf around my neck, covering up my dog collar. About a dozen bikes, ridden by sinister-looking figures in black leathers, roared past in the opposite direction. I felt almost sick with fear. I was in such a panic that I opened up the throttle and fled past the Ace as fast as I could. This wasn't where you'd expect to find a vicar.
Anywhere where motorcyclists gathered was a place where normal people, respectable people, wouldn't go.
A few weeks later, he tried again. He wrote, "I entered the forecourt at the Ace. It was packed with bikes. Hundreds of boys were milling around, laughing and talking. This is it," I thought. "I shall almost certainly lose my trousers or end up in the canal." Yet gradually they were won over by Shergold and his inclusive, non-judgmental style.
"Although this is a church club, its purpose is to bring together young people with a common interest, motorcycling."
Their shared interest convinced the rockers at the Ace that the 59 Club was somewhere worth a look. As well as a new place to meet, it organised rallies and ride-outs, even activities like sub-aqua diving. Bikers joined in their thousands, and the 59 Club became the biggest motorcycle club in the world. For those who joined the 59 Club, it meant more than the establishment could ever have dreamed.
My first moment or night of going there was definitely, for me, life-defining. It really was. And it kept me on a path within motorcycling for the rest of my life, really.
But it was still somewhere the rockers and turn-up boys could revel in their lifestyle. By the mid-1960s, though, that lifestyle was under threat. Rock and roll seemed to have had its day. A younger generation was coming through that did things very differently. They became known as mods, famed for their love of sharp suits instead of leathers, coffee bars over transport calves. They wanted soul music, not rock and roll, and worst of all, from a rocker's point of view, scooters, not motorbikes.
How would you explain this fanatical devotion by scooter enthusiasts for their gleaming machine?
You kind of like got the fact that they were good for riding on and wearing decent clothes. But they it's a mod. How can you get pleasure from riding it, you think? Like they're like little edge riders, you know, you just, how can you get pleasure from it? It was alien to us.
Mods represented progress, with their Italian scooters, a more international outlook. Rockers and motorbikes were being left behind as the rest of Britain moved on. Mods were looking to the future, and tension between the two saw things turn ugly.
If you get into a fight with a mod, you've got to watch it all the time, you know. They'll pull your hair, they'll claw at you.
They started, you know what rockers are like, don't you?
It really has come to something when people can't take a short holiday without the threat of long-haired youngsters with knives indulging in an orgy of hooliganism.
Only a handful of clashes happened between mods and rockers at seaside resorts like Brighton, but it was too late. The press and polite society had their pantomime villains.
Adolescents on motorbikes became identified with thugs. They rubbed in prejudices against motorbikes that many people have always had about them. Noise, danger, the dirt and the discomfort. Rockers' misbehaviour amounted to a knockout blow to the prestige of the two-wheeled machine in this country.
What do you think about society?
I don't know, don't bother me.
As the media fretted about delinquent youth, the mystique was fading fast from British motorcycles. The industry began losing its battle against a flood of Japanese imports rising throughout the 60s. These were humdrum practical machines designed for commuters. Bikes guaranteed to get you to work rather than get you excited.
British bikes had this thing called character, which is a euphemism for being not very reliable.
Yet what couldn't be taken away was the spirit of fun, coolness and rebellion that British bikes had represented to the world for so long. It's no accident that whilst rockers struggled to find a place in 60s society, their style and attitude became legend. The motorbikes they blasted through the streets on are still lusted after. And even 50 years later, have a look all of their own. The restless energy of Lawrence, the bravery of TT racers, and the individuality of the Tun-Up boys took a utilitarian form of transport and gave it a very British take, a full throttle affair.
You couldn't really put it in words. It was just such a fantastic feeling.
And there's more Time Shift here on BBC Four next Monday at 9 with When Coal Was King. Next tonight, though, we're staying on the bike for a race out on the open road and how the Northwest was won. We can't